Hi, I'm Russ Camarda, an independent filmmaker and actor in New York, and in between the chances I get to do my creative projects, I love to sit down and talk with other artists to see how it is they do what they do, how they take art and use their craft to reveal truth to an audience. So in this series of conversations, you'll meet some people you may recognize, some people you won't recognize, but they're all independent artists, and we'll get in-depth in a long-form conversation to see how it is they do what they do. Welcome to Art, Craft, Truth. This time on Art, Craft, Truth, we return to the world of music with guitar player Alex Nolan. Throughout her fantastic career, she's been the lead guitarist for various artists, including touring with Cyndi Lauper, playing for the Broadway show Jagged, Little Pill.
She's a contributing writer to Premier Guitar Magazine, and she's also a fantastic guitar teacher. So she's going to educate me on the craft of guitar and what it's like to be a working sideman musician in the music industry. I hope you enjoy her as much as I've enjoyed talking to her, Alex Nolan.
How are you?
Hey, how are you doing?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
Awesome. I was just testing my microphone.
Can you hear me?
Very well.
All right.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Cool.
This is cool, Alex. Thank you so much for doing this. This is very...
Thanks for having me.
I love talking to musicians because I'm so far out of my depth. It's so fun.
Are you not a musician at all?
No, not a musician at all. I mean, I'm an actor and filmmaker and stuff, so mm-hmm. I come from that world.
Yeah.
What the coolest part for me is, like I said, and I'm mm-hmm. going to give you my general disclaimer when I talk mm-hmm. to musicians, is if I sound like an idiot with some of these questions, that's the good part. That's what's fun. So you're also a teacher of this. So what's cool about this is you're going to educate me and everybody else about the craft of what you do.
Oh boy. Okay. Sounds good.
Right. And that's kind of the thrust of it too. Is we'll go through like your life and career highlights and things and all the fun stories and stuff, but really I want to focus on how it is you do what you do, like the actual craft of your mm-hmm. art. So first of all, how are you making out with aren't you doing Jagged Little Pill, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's been canned for almost a year now, right? What's going on with that?
We just passed the year of the shutdown, so it's a little weird, you know.
Yeah.
It's hard to believe, but I think Broadway is hopeful about the fall.
Wow, fall.
I mean, officially, the word is still that they're shut down until May 31st.
Wow.
But if we're still not in line to get vaccinated, and we haven't started moving forward, so it's hard to believe that it would begin on June 1st at this point.
Wow.
You know,
they're not even going to do like limited capacity type thing or
so the issue with that is that the Broadway business model doesn't work for limited capacity.
Yeah,
if you know what I mean.
Yeah, no, there's not enough cheddar for that.
they're not gonna open unless they can sell all the tickets.
Wow. Oh man.
So and then of course, you know, once the restrictions are lifted, then the issue is will they be able to sell that many tickets? Will people feel comfortable?
Right.
I don't know.
My guess, I don't know what you think, but my mm-hmm. guess is, especially for things like that, the hunger is so pent up. Mm-hmm. At this point, once you tell people you can go to the restaurant, you can go to the show, you can go to the ball game, mm-hmm. they're going to go.
They'll do it.
They're going to go. I mean,
yeah,
I think so.
Yeah.
I think the general attitude is we've taken the pot off the boil a little bit with this, and I think it's just going to simmer down a little bit. Cool. All right. Well, I hope we're going to talk about that as we get
sure.
into this. But but I wanted to see where we were at with that. So let's start at the beginning with you. This will be
okay.
fun. Where are you from originally? Actually,
originally I'm from Manhattan.
Oh, really? Oh, so you're a New Yorker, born and raised.
Not so much raised, but born.
Okay.
We lived there till I was 5 years old. And then we moved up to the Hudson Valley.
Okay.
So most of my life, I grew up in the Hudson Valley in Millbrook, New York.
Awesome. All
which
right.
is about 90 miles north.
Right. So you're a New Yorker. I mean, I grew up on Long Island.
Yeah.
That's where I still am. So I'm a New Yorker.
Yeah.
That's how it is. We're, you know, mm-hmm. we're in and out of that town all the time.
Sure.
So as a kid, mm-hmm. were you always inclined? Were you always musically inclined? Did you want to do other things? Was art always part of your life?
Yeah, I knew from a very young age, from a, like when I was 5 years old, I started to ask about playing, like if I could play electric guitar. my mom is a singer, actress, performer, and at the time in the 80s, my father co-owned a cabaret nightclub.
Oh, wow.
And so, yeah, so I was kind of like observing that world, and my parents were friends with a lot of cabaret singers from those days, and so I was definitely around music a lot.
Wow.
And but I something about like rock and roll and electric guitar just spoke to me, so I begged my parents for an electric guitar, and when I was 7, Santa Claus finally brought me one.
Sweet. So yeah. What was it? What was the stuff that you were listening to that put you in that down that road that you fell in love with the guitar?
So I have an older sister. We're almost 8 years apart. So when I was very young, she was listening to Cyndi Lauper and like, you know, yeah, all the pop music at that time. And I remember her getting Nevermind by Nirvana, that album,
okay,
91, which is when I started playing guitar, and just hearing the intro to Smells Like Teen Spirit, just that electric guitar, I'm like, that's so awesome. It's so cool.
So there was this dirty power of that grunge scene at the time that spoke to you. So
yeah.
So I'm a little older than you. I probably got, I'm more of the 80s, but when I grew up, I was listening to the stuff that was the era mm-hmm. before me. So it was always yep. Hendrix and Zeppelin, and you know, that was the stuff that I grew up.
Right. You know. Don't you always feel like you were born too late?
You know what? At the time,
you know?
At the time, I definitely felt that way because, you're looking at your, although, I mean, I loved all the stuff at the time, you know, Van Halen and a lot of stuff of my high school era was great too. And then later on U2 and then, you know, Radiohead and all that stuff as I grew into it. But at the time you're like long hair, denim jacket. You're like, I should have been born in 68, man. I should have been a teenager in 68, you know? So yeah, that's cool. So,
I know.
So, was there, because they were in the arts, was there any hesitation to Santa Claus getting you that guitar, or were they excited about you doing it?
There was no hesitation. I think they just, you know, it was strange, I think, especially then, for a little girl to want to play, I don't know, to like beg to play electric guitar, and they probably just wanted to make sure I was serious,
right,
you know?
Right.
I imagine, you know, I mean, they were super supportive of me playing music. I think it was just like,
yeah, why yeah. that? Why the electric yeah. guitar? Yeah, right. Don't you want to be a singer or something?
Right, yeah. Okay. Right.
That's cool.
Piano, maybe.
Yeah. So, yeah. So did you find you had a facility for it right away? Like, was it hard to learn, or did you dive right into it?
I would say I dove right into it. I started taking lessons about 6 months after I got the guitar, but even before then, I was like pretending I already knew, you know, like carrying it around with me all around the house. Wow. And just like trying to play things by ear.
Wow.
And I you know what, I really wanted to do it, so I wasn't turned off by like my fingers hurting, or like nothing bothered me about the whole experience.
Right the love was the work, you know, so you
yeah,
didn't have to.
Yeah.
So what was the what was some of the first things you were learning and playing, right? Like were you like, oh, I gotta learn that Nirvana song, or like what were the things you wanted to do?
Yeah, I definitely, that was an early one. Yeah. I remember learning Hotel California pretty early on.
That's great.
Yeah. I think that was maybe the first solo I learned.
Oh really?
Yeah,
that's
which
cool.
I'm like now, and I've taught that solo, and it's like it's really long too. Like yeah. You have to
and
be, it's,
and there's two in. Guitars harmonizing on there.
Yeah, exactly. right. Well, yeah. I've taught it many times to guitar students, and most people give up like somewhere in the middle, just because like it's just too long.
Right.
It's too much for
the Eagles. For were people. The Eagles were good for that. You can say take it to the limit. As many times as humanly
and they possible. Did.
And they did. And they certainly did.
Right.
That's so cool. So what was the aspiration? Like, you clearly you wanted, this was not, You weren't doing chamber music. You wanted to rock out. So that's pretty cool. So what was the aspiration eventually to find like-minded kids and get a band, or like, how did you end up playing?
That's a great question. I would have loved to have other kids that were that young, right, that cared about it, or that like, I like fantasized about having a band, you right. know, getting to play with other kids. But I went to a small school where like there were 15 kids in my class.
Wow.
And nobody, you know, like they thought it was cool, but nobody committed to it. Like to taking an instrument, or like some of my friends were like, oh yeah, I'm gonna get a drum set, and then they'd take like a couple weeks of worth of lessons, and that was it.
Oh.
So nobody took it seriously, and you know, at that age, it's I think it's hard to find kids that are
Is it not until you get like out of school and into you're going off to college kind of thing, or like when do you finally get to, what are you doing to play to satisfy yourself? Is it just
oh yeah, well I was taking lessons, so I started taking lessons when I was I guess about 8, and every week, and then when I was 12 I also started taking drum lessons.
Oh, yeah.
So I did the two back to back every week at the local music store.
That's so
and
cool.
Yeah, it was fun.
Yeah.
And, you know, at that point, I thought that I wanted to do what I ended up doing, which was playing guitar for somebody, like being the guitarist in the band.
Right.
Not like I wasn't excited about like being the front person or
right.
So I knew who I was. I guess they say that, right?
Yeah.
When you're like really little, you really know who you are.
It's true. So you didn't have any, did you have like aspirations or thoughts of like being a songwriter, you know, or writing music?
I did.
You did. Okay.
Yeah, I did. But not till like, you know, at some point people started telling me like, well, you should really do your own thing. And I think still now people are like, oh, but do you do your own thing? You know, it's always thought of as the, I don't know, the most, maybe I don't want to say respectable, but you must want to do your own thing.
Right.
You know?
Right, right, right.
And so when I was, I would say like 17, I started like, okay, I guess I can sing and I'll write my own songs. And I recorded a 4-song EP when I was 18.
Nice.
And then, you know, for a few years there, then through college, I was studying guitar. I did go to school for guitar, but I was thinking that like, oh, I'm going to do my own thing. I'm going to have my own project and have a rock band, and it's going to be my name.
Right. You know, it's interesting. I just interviewed last week a buddy of mine who's a jazz drummer. He's a jazz and rhythm and blues soul drummer with like the Dap Kings and other folks that he's worked with. And he's like, he's just putting an album. He's been doing this for 30 years. Like I never decided to do my thing. Like I was always, I like to be the session guy. I like to be the, you know what I mean? So people, that's a gig. That's part of the gig is work.
Totally.
Yeah, collaborating with other artists. It doesn't have to be your thing. So that's interesting that, you know, you didn't have that mindset right off the bat. It came later.
Exactly. Right.
So where did you go to school?
I went to the University of Southern California in Los Angeles.
Nice. And
for
music, didn't you study? Wasn't there another or a part of that school that you studied at or something?
I started as the School of Music is called Thornton School of Music.
Okay, I knew it was something like that. I couldn't place it.
Yeah. So I started as a jazz guitar major. They call that major studio/jazz guitar, I guess, is the LA, you know, hip way of
sure.
No. But so it was really cool. And it was mostly jazz but also part of what it takes to be a studio musician.
Okay.
So I did that for 2 years, and then early in my junior year decided that, you know, I had kind of decided that like, okay, but I'm not going to be a guitar player, so maybe I should actually focus on studying things that will be more useful to me if I do my own project. So I switched to music business. So I actually, my degree is in music industry.
Wow. So at some point, I'm sure that comes in handy now.
A little bit. I'm glad that I got to like do a little different things.
Right. So at some point you thought, I'm not going to be a guitar player.
Yep. Huh. Yep.
Okay. And what was it about? First of all, let's dive into a little craft here before I get into all that stuff. So coming out of your, you know, rocking out youth, the original attraction for that electric guitar. Now you're going to school and you're studying jazz guitar.
Yep.
Explain the difference, some of the differences for us laymen about what that is about, and how did you react to learning that particular craft?
Sure. I mean, I had been preparing for that, that study through high school. So I'd played in jazz ensembles and like they have what's called all county. I don't know if they do that. Yeah. Where they put together musicians from different high schools to have like, I guess they say
the
like the best, the most, the recommended group. But that was a great experience. And, you have to sight read arrangements and play specific parts as part of an orchestra. So that was part of my preparation for studying jazz. But when I got to the school, there were, I guess, 10 of us, 10 guitar players in my class. And most of it was kind of like learning songs, learning tunes, they say, standards, and being able to play them in any key, of course. And being able to improvise over the changes of that particular song. So they used playing standards as the way to address playing over changes, improvising.
That makes total sense.
Playing over changes.
No,
yeah,
absolutely,
yeah.
Because you're it's similar to kind of what we do. If you know, you hear actors talk about improvising. There's no straight sort of just whipping stuff off the top of your head and pulling it out of your ass kind of thing. There's a foundation of the story you're trying to tell, an objective you're trying to reach, and then you riff off of that and you allow.
Exactly.
And that's basically what they're doing. They're giving you a standard to lay down a foundation that you can play changes over.
Yep.
And did you like that? Was it fun?
I did. It just wasn't like, no, I mean, I like it and I appreciate it. And I grew up with it. I don't really gig as a jazz musician anymore. There was a time, maybe like 10 years ago, or as I was still playing with a couple jazz artists.
I saw the one, the bass player one.
Exactly. Amanda Ruzza, who's like an amazing Brazilian jazz bassist.
Right. Which is
but
odd.
That's also like,
that's a, there's an what? Odd a front person jazz bass.
Totally. I know.
Never seen that before.
I know.
Other than Jackal
Pastorius
or something, I've never seen.
Exactly. It's pretty edgy too. Like there are elements of rock and roll in that gig too, I would say. Like, and she wanted it to be that way, you know.
Right.
So that was, it worked out for me. But you know, in the end, like it's not like what excites me the most.
Right. The rock world was calling you.
Yeah, totally.
So at what point is it, somewhere in school or out of school, when does the guitar come back where it's like, wait, I can do this. I can play.
Yeah. So a week before graduation, at USC, I still don't really know what exactly I'm going to do. I thought about moving back to New York, maybe going to culinary school. not necessarily to become a chef, but I've always been really interested in cooking. I still do. It's like my hobby. Yeah. Oh, nice. Yeah. Well, it's similar.
I'm a food addict, food network addict. So I have been since the beginning. So
totally. I know. It's so like,
it's like, oh, it's Chopped On. I can watch that for another hour.
Top
and a
half. Chef. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I'm with you. I'm with you. So I thought about that lightly. I just wasn't sure. And then, so I got an email, like I said, a week before graduation, that was from a band in Nashville, a 7-piece all-female country band that was looking for a replacement for their guitarist. So I got the email through the department of my school, and the band had emailed the department saying, please encourage any female guitarists that you have, may have, if they're, you know, ask them if they're interested. So, you know, as we know that female guitarists are still just like not common, you know, it's hard to find, especially that do it, on a professional level as a guitarist,
right?
You know,
right? Yeah, they're not just sort of playing rhythm along to their own,
sure, know, which is great too. Yeah, it's just sure. That, yeah, you know, there aren't a lot of women who pursue that career. So, so the department emails me, and I have had two email addresses, and so I got it in one inbox, and the first one I was like, nah, I couldn't do that. Like, I don't play country. I don't know if I like it. I'm not going to be a guitar player, whatever. So then I opened the other inbox later that afternoon, and I started to think about it, and I was like, I don't know. Maybe I'll just write them back. Why not? Like, I'm not going to do it, but why not?
Sure.
Well, so I emailed them, and immediately the band leader called me on the phone. And, you know, was trying to get me to come to audition. So a few days later, I fly to Nashville, like between like the end of school and my exams, I flew to Nashville and auditioned for this band. And I ended up doing it, graduated, moved to Nashville. It just happened.
Wow.
And
thank God for multiple email accounts.
isn't that funny?
That's
how
bizarre.
Like,
yeah,
you make a choice that like you don't think, I don't know,
right now you
changes your
you,
life.
Yeah, exactly. So you moved to Nashville and joined this band.
Yeah,
what was the plan? Was there a plan that you had abandoned? You know, this happens like so fast. Like, what were you going to do when you got out of school? What was the plan?
So I don't think, right, well, I didn't really have a definite plan, you know. I mean I thought, like I said, maybe study some culinary arts.
Right, that's right.
And then, you know, and then there was a time where I thought of, so even this, like when I joined the band, I was in it for a little over a year. But even after that, I was still thinking like, okay, time to get serious.
Right.
Yeah. So like I've thought about music law at some point too. Just maybe that was a good idea.
Wasn't sure. Let me ask you this question. This is interesting. Mm-hmm. So, first of all, we'll talk about the Nashville experience, but what do you think it is in, and this happens to a lot of us artists, what do you think it is that crept in that kept saying, let's time to get serious, or when I'm done with this? Like, what do you think that is? Where does that come from?
I think it just came from, you know, what people say, and like what the idea is, and like the idea that pursuing a career in the arts isn't practical.
Right.
You know, and I supported it. I just didn't think I was exceptional.
Right.
And, you know, I didn't think that, I thought it would be too hard, and, you know, it wasn't practical.
Right. So when you're in Nashville, what's that experience like at that time? You know, was it a whole different kind of world? Because that's a like workman-like regimented town for musicians, right? People who just, that's all they do is they you know, 9 to 5, they're working on their music kind of thing. Was it that kind of scene for you?
Absolutely. Well, you know, the gig that I had, we were what they call road warriors, where, and this is what a lot of people do in Nashville, like they live in Nashville, but they're not there most of the time. Mm. So we would go out, you know, we would leave on like, I don't know, Wednesday morning and drive to the first gig for the week, you know, to Georgia or something, and then go to Alabama and then go down to Louisiana. Wow. And then return home like sometime on Sunday. So most of the week we were traveling around, you know, the South.
Right.
And we did go all over the country too. But
and what kind of stuff were you playing?
So it was mostly country and classic rock covers. Okay. They had some original music.
So like Southern rock, like Lynyrd Skynyrd, Allman Brothers type vibe?
Totally, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, AC/DC. It was a road show, though. Okay. So it was, because like I said, it was 7-piece, all female. And what the band leader would do was call departments of like music departments, Berkeley. They would ask, like, who are the best girls? Like, who's the best bass player that you have that's female? Who's the best violinist? And recruit girls.
Smart.
For the band. And they were really awesome.
I'm sure they were.
Badass. Like, I remember when I auditioned, just being like, had like blown away and really intimidated, because I had never been around that many female musicians that were, which, you know, is ridiculous. But it was awesome.
Wow.
It was really impressive.
Was it like a battle, or were you the only one they were really focusing on for guitar?
Well, I thought it was a battle, but I would come to find out that they had a very hard time finding somebody. And they were actually, they thought it was a good fit.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So it was great. It was awesome. But yeah, we would play like Devil Went Down to Georgia and,
right,
you know,
Daniels.
And the fiddle player would do a dance on a table. And it was like a really fun road show.
And was
they had a huge following. I mean, they still exist, actually.
What was the name of the band?
Mustang Sally.
And obviously well-received across your
tour. Yeah, people love that. They love it. We would go play on this this little island off of the coast of Ohio. You know, I don't know if you've ever...
never heard of that.
So they have, a couple islands, but one of them's called Put-In Bay. Like, Put-In-Bay,
okay.
Ohio. And it's like Cabo in
in Cincinnati,
Ohio, exactly. Right. But it's a little island, and you have to take a ferry to get there. And it's a freaking party island,
that's awesome.
You know? Yeah. Well, yeah.
I guess it depends.
It was fun, but we would go there and play for like 10 nights in a row. We'd do 3 sets every night, so we'd just stay there and play, and people would party, and it was crazy.
Wow.
And yeah.
And you did this for a year.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a cover band, basically, and some original stuff? Some original.
Exactly.
Were you involved in writing or no?
No. So most members of the band were interested in that original music side of it. And their aspiration really was to become a recording artist.
Sure.
Like for their original music. Whereas I just wanted I was in it for the experience, and it I learned so much from doing that gig, and just like being like thrown into the fire, you know, like having to learn over 100 songs in like a week, and just be like playing. It was crazy. But yes, so eventually, you know, they wanted to really pursue the recording artist side of it, and that just didn't. I didn't believe in the project, actually.
Okay.
So
it wasn't. Yeah. It still wasn't the rock out Alex that we were waiting to see.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't my dream.
Yeah, it wasn't your dream. But what's cool is what you articulated there is a lot of people don't realize when they see working musicians, session musicians, even event, and mm-hmm. you know, you guys are like walking fake books. The amount of songs that are in your head and in your hands is unbelievable. So that experience is invaluable, I would imagine, just doing all this.
Totally.
And then you can do it in any key and anywhere with anybody. And that's incredibly valuable. So when you get out of that band, what was the next step for you? Where did you go?
So at that point, I moved back to New York. And which, you know, my family was still there. So I moved back home in the Hudson Valley. And I still didn't think like I was going to pursue guitar. So I wasn't sure exactly what I was going to do next. But I talked to a friend of mine named Chris Bono, who's a guitarist. And I knew him from working at a guitar camp, a summer camp. And he was a teacher there. And he always like... He became kind of a mentor to me, and we're still friends, and we play gigs together once in a while. But anyway, so I talked to him on the phone, and he was like, you know, encouraging about me just going for it, like to do this side man thing. Right. And I was kind of like, you really though? Like, you think I could be a side man? He was like, yeah. He's like, do you have a car payment? And I was like, what? Do you have a car payment? Like, do you need to cover expenses right now? I know you're living at home. And I was like, no, that's fine. I'm cool. He was like, okay, great. So look at the Village Voice. Wow. And, you know, just open it up and look and see who's playing. Look for songwriter showcases and go. Like, go at least like 3 nights a week in the city and just like go listen to people. And talk to whoever's around and like maybe give your business card and just meet people. So I was like, okay, all right. You know, it just seemed like, why not?
Right.
I was, you know.
You were free.
But I was like.
He was checking to make sure. It's like
23 years old. Right. And like, I didn't, you know, and I was like in a fortunate position to not be like, right, to not like, oh my God, I have a car payment. And
right.
So I got a waitressing job at a Japanese steakhouse in Poughkeepsie, New York.
Sweet.
Yeah. And I waited tables maybe 4 nights a week, and I went to the city the other nights.
Wow. And you just started networking and meeting other musicians Are you sort of selective as to what you're going to see at that point? You're like, I want to check that out, or like, what are the kinds of circles of music that you're looking at that point?
That's a great question.
I try. I do my best.
Yeah. I was mostly looking for songwriters. Mm. So songwriter showcases, they would do stuff at the Bitter End. Sometimes Cornelia Street Cafe. Which
I don't know what's around anymore.
Crazy. Yeah. I'm trying to think other places. You know, like Arlene's Grocery.
Okay.
Yeah. Just mostly singer-songwriter showcases.
And just listening and watching people do their thing and then introducing yourself kind of thing. That's just increasing your circles. So when's the first, what's the first phone calls that come out of this? Like who wants to jam with you, who wants to play with
you? So a couple of people who I kind of met from going to that. One person was a songwriter who lived in Westchester County, which is, for those of you who, it's the county north, just outside of the city. And actually, that's where I live now.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So this singer-songwriter told me, you know, there's a lot of, since you live in the Hudson Valley, like there's so many open jams in Westchester County. And, you know, I know this singer who runs a jam, and it would be great if I could see if she'll let you sit in and play some songs with the house band as opposed to, you know, as opposed to just like being called in like to jam with other people. So, it kind of just stemmed like that. And he recommended like jams to check out in Westchester. So I started doing that, which was outside of the city and not necessarily so connected to the scene, I would say. And I came to learn. But I did meet a lot of musicians there and started playing with bands in Westchester that gave me the opportunity to perform a lot more, like in addition to like having been on the road, you know, and they were, you know, like just do like $100 gigs, right, like more sure. often. So that was great. I met a guitar player named and singer named Greg Hoy, who I'm also still friends with. And he was the first person that hired me to play as part of like an original band in okay. the city.
And what was the kind of music you were doing?
Rock.
Rock, just straight up rock, yeah.
Yeah, indie rock, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, so he called me for, I'm trying to remember where the first gig I played with. I don't know, we played at Arlene's Grocery and some, you know, I know CBGB's wasn't there anymore, yeah. but R Bar and Crash Mansion, I don't know if they're still there now.
The city's different now, you know, it's
so crazy.
So at this point, has it sunk yeah. into your head that, oh, okay, I guess I'm a guitar player?
And it, yeah, it. It's yeah. it started to. It started to. I mean, it was still like a long way to go, like right. from right. trying, you know, like planting the seeds and just everything stemming from, right. from, you know, just meeting people here and there.
Now, let me ask you this. I'm going to go off on a little tangent here before we get into, because yeah. you eventually end up. We're going to get you to Broadway. That's pretty exciting. And playing with Cyndi Lauper's band mm-hmm. And you did the Meredith Vieira TV show thing.
Yeah,
so you've had some,
yeah,
you cool. had some really fun gigs, but just as a tangent here for a second, mm-hmm. Did you have heroes? Like, were there guitar heroes that you had? Was it the Eddie Van Halens and Steve Vai's and stuff of that era? Or like, who were your heroes?
Sure. I mean, I was definitely a huge fan of Eddie Van Halen's, for sure. I was really into Smashing Pumpkins, actually.
Interesting.
like obsessed with them. And Billy Corgan is actually like an amazing guitar player.
And I think I read somewhere that you got to play with him at some point, right?
I did. Yeah. I did once.
That's
yeah.
pretty neat.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think I was more into just like maybe not obsessed with guitar players specifically,
okay.
but the music, like the radio, pop music, just the overall thing, like, and how the guitar contributed to that.
Right.
So if I had to pick guitar players that were my heroes, I would say Eddie Van Halen, Billy Corgan, Stevie Ray Vaughan, for sure.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. So,
and then later, like, Dominic Miller, of course, he's Sting's guitar player. Mm. And as I would say, like, as a side musician, like as what I do now, he's been such an inspiration.
Why is that?
I'm a big fan.
What is it about?
Oh, man.
I mean, just again, for the moron that I am, give me the difference.
No.
Give me the difference between these types of characters, you know,
Absolutely. The
Eddie Van Halen type stuff and what you're talking about now with Sting's guitar.
Sure. Well, I think Dominic Miller is an amazing guitarist, like has the ability to do very impressive technical things, but he plays as a true side musician that supports whatever vision the artist has. So in this case, Sting,
sure.
Who he's worked with since, I think, 91 was the first album he was on. So really long time now, but you know, where the artist has a vision of what they want to create and someone who can like put aside whatever ego they may have about saying something, you know, like,
right.
like look at me, but rather just enhancing what the artist's vision is.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's similar in, on my side of the fence when directors collaborate with cinematographers, and it's, you know, there's a certain look that you need to tell the story, certain lenses you use for certain things, certain
color correction you do later. I mean, there's a story you're trying to tell, and everything has to support that. So regardless of what everybody's vision as an individual artist is, it has to support the story that's under it. So that's kind of what the same thing. If the artist is saying something on that album, on that record, and you're there to facilitate that vision in some way.
Absolutely. Especially, yes. And it's, I like that analogy with the cinematography because just visually how things appear with, you know, that create that story. And as a side guitar player, like we do that sonically,
right.
And with pedals and different sounds, and you can really tell a story.
And I read, I don't do very much research, but I picked a few things, and there was one line I saw you wrote in an article somewhere about rhythm guitar playing, and how it's like for a lot of guitar players, it's like eating your vegetables. You know, it's like, you know, I got to do it, but, you know, it doesn't have that showcase of the, you know, shredding
right.
that solo. But talk about that aspect of the craft, you know, the idea of supporting the rest of the piece.
Oh, man, I love playing rhythm guitar. I love it. I mean, really, like you're like the drummer when you're playing rhythm guitar. You're and the bass player. You're really like the combination, the marriage between those two aspects, where you're laying down the groove. And when you feel confident about that, about playing rhythm, it's like you're driving the train, and it can make the singer feel very confident, which often they're not. You know, and so playing rhythm, you have that ability to be like, it's right here, like, follow me, I won't let you down.
Right.
No.
And you said it's like sort of the combination of being the drummer and the bass player, but when you're playing rhythm, is there this sort of, you know, especially in a band like that where it's a four or five people, where you're in marriage with that drummer who's keeping the time?
Absolutely.
There's like a real groove that's, explain what that feels
sure.
like and how you do that.
Yeah, that's a great question. I feel like when I'm playing guitar, so I'm right-handed, so my right hand is the actual picking, strumming hand.
Right.
And for me, that's like what it looks like when you watch a drummer playing the hi-hat
sure.
or the ride cymbal.
Mm-hmm.
It's that same thing. So like if we're playing a rock song and they're playing eighth notes, which are one and two and three and four, and that's going to be the same subdivision that I'm playing on rhythm guitar. And with a great drummer, you know, you don't need to like watch that happen necessarily to really lock in.
Right.
But it can be fun to watch what they're doing and to really lay into like any accent or nuance that like, you know, to
right.
match where they're maybe more by accenting. I mean, playing something slightly louder in volume, which creates groove actually,
right.
you know, like if I just play like, you know, that's just even. But if I go, I'm playing the same
right.
rhythm, technically, right. but accenting gives it a groove.
Oh, you have so articulated something I've been trying to wrap my head around. It's awesome. Because, like I said, I just did one with this jazz drummer. And, you know, he was hired to score a film of mine. He was playing in the band. And the composer, guitar player, who said, you got to get this guy. You got to use him. And I was asking, why did he say that? Why did he have to use you? And he's like, well, he's like, there's a dynamic in how you do these things. And he said, and it's just, you know, if my hand is hitting the cymbal like this, but I turn it like this, it's a different tonality. And like you said, there's a nuance to all of these things that creates the groove. And
yes.
that the way you just described that, just totally, I totally get it. And that's
cool.
Neat. That must be an electric feeling for you as a musician when you're in that syncopated moment, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's really fun. That's why, to me, like, I don't know, I'd rather do that all day than take a solo, actually.
What are some of the fun, can you pick out some moments, probably hard with your career, where where you can zone in on one, you know, particular groove that was like, oh man, when we did that with that person, that was like, can you think of any like that?
Sure. So I play with this artist, Toshi Reagon, who is a long time, I'll say New York hero, but Toshi has a huge following and has been an international artist. But Toshi Reagon plays every year, has done a birthday series at Joe's Pub every January. She does 5 shows and they all sell out, which is really hard to do. And I'm trying to think, she thinks she's done it for 30 years there. Anyway, so that being said, I always have the opportunity to play with great musicians, with Toshi. And the last few years, it's been primarily a trio of myself and Ganessa James on bass, she's a great bass player, and Allison Miller, who's an amazing drummer. And I feel like we play a lot of grooves together in rehearsal, even. Like, forget the performance, but just like when we're playing, rehearsing, it's a special thing, like where we're just like,
right, you just grooving.
Yeah. And we've played together so much that we really know each other, you know, personally, but musically, you know.
Right. Now, I heard just another little tangent I can go off on there, because there's two things. There's working together, and by the way, thank goodness the leaf blower guy decided to take a break.
I'm sorry, I know. I was going to say something, but then I thought,
it's okay.
You know,
it's part of it's the texture of where we live. I live on Long Island, so I'm surprised they're not doing it outside my door too. So, you know, that's what happens when the landscapers come around this time of year. Spring cleanup.
Exactly.
But don't forget, don't worry about it. It's part of the fun. So there's you know, working together, you know, as musicians together, recording or rehearsing or jamming, but then you add the audience. And what does that do to the groove and the performance? Because you're not only in sync with the people on stage with you, but there's an energy of live theater that's happening there.
Totally. Does
it change the way you play? Does it influence the actual craft of what you're doing at the moment? Or are you locked in? Is there a fourth wall, or are you part of it?
Yeah, I think that we are locked in, and there is that like nervous energy often. I'm sure that you as an actor feel this too, where sometimes like you do things that you couldn't have planned.
Right.
You know, and maybe you wouldn't have wanted to do, like, had you planned it. But it's that, you know, just that extra element of surprise. So feeling the nervous energy maybe from the audience and the in the moment aspect where you may do some. Yeah, I'm trying to think of a more specific example.
That's okay.
But
it's literally the truth of what the audience is bringing. They're bringing the live truth that's happening. So when you do something, it resonates with them and they react, and then produces, I would think, a reaction in you as well. You know, you bend that note maybe just a little longer or something. I don't know.
Exactly. Yes, you're right. And sometimes you go for things out of that energy that you feel like, I mean, I've done that a lot. Like I want to go with that energy and I do something that I feel doesn't work, you know, like, okay, that was dumb or something.
Right.
But then sometimes I listen back to the recording. I'm like, oh
yeah.
Well, it sounds real. It sounds
right.
Yeah, you know, like I was with the audience.
Yeah, maybe. The truth doesn't hide. It eventually finds you somewhere on stage and with the audience. What's some of the biggest audiences you've gotten to play in front of, and what's that vibe like?
The biggest, the biggest audience that I've gotten to play with, and I'm sure will ever play for, it was the Women's March on Washington in 2017.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you're talking.
I think they say that was like the biggest gathering, they say, of people ever.
Where were you situated? Like, where did you play?
So I played in the house band on the main stage. Wow. I was standing on the stage the whole time.
Wow.
So like if you see, you know, Ashley Judd's I'm a Nasty Woman speech, you see my face right behind her.
That's
so cool.
I
was there. But yeah, on the mall, there was, I don't know, they don't know how many people were there, but at least 500,000, anywhere between that and a million.
Holy shit. So when
it's just as far as you can see.
So when you walk out onto that and strap that thing on your shoulder, it's like, what the fuck? You know, like, what is this? Holy shit. Yeah. It's incredible.
It was crazy. Yeah. Actually, we didn't know how big it was going to be.
Right.
And it wasn't quite like that because we got there very early. It was like 6 a.m.
Okay.
And sound checked and played like right away.
Right.
And as the day went on, it became bigger and bigger and more people came in. And then I was getting texts from friends and family like, I'm watching you on CNN right now. And I was like, what? Like, we didn't even know that it was going to be
right.
an event that was on every channel. And
wow.
And I had no idea.
And can you feel it the same way? Because is the distance between you and that humongous crowd too great? Like, are they close or, like, I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I could feel it.
You could
it.
Feel it, sure.
Especially, okay. like, what it was. And it was really
wow.
Incredible feeling.
And what were some of the things that you played that rocked the crowd?
Yeah. I played a song with the Indigo Girls, among other things. A song called Go, which was a lot of fun.
Mm.
We played a song with Janelle Monáe. And I actually played a drum on that song because it was percussive and not so, you know, there wasn't like harmony.
Right, right.
So that was really exciting.
That's
too.
That's awesome.
Man. Oh, Alicia Keys. I'm like, I feel like I'm forgetting
yeah,
somebody
important.
Yeah. We played part of Girl on Fire.
Mm.
So we played the chorus with her,
right.
which was very cool.
And are you thinking in something like that, do like visions of Woodstock come through your head? Are you like,
no.
Are you like, holy shit, this is my.
No.
No, you're not thinking that?
Woodstock? No.
I mean, that was huge. You know, you're seeing 500,000 people.
Oh, of course it was huge. Yeah. I don't know. It didn't feel like that.
Wow. Well, the vibe, obviously, a little different, but the crowd size was pretty amazing.
Sure.
That's
sure.
very cool. All right, so let's move ahead a little bit. And so are you. Then do you become sort of this career kind of sideman character where you're just playing with different artists and recording mm-hmm. with different artists? Or when did you hook up like with Cyndi Lauper later on where you were in a band touring around? Or like how does your career kind of find its way there?
Yeah. Yeah, so let's see. From the time I started networking in the city, that was... Right, I'm trying to think. Like 2007.
Okay.
I did a couple things between that time and now. I'm trying to think. In 2008, I played with someone contacted me about like YouTube videos and said, "We want you to play with this young country artist and double as a chaperone because she's a teenager."
Aww.
So I did that for 18 months. So that was a thing where I flew. I was still living in New York, but I would fly about every week to Seattle, let's say. And then we would go and perform at the radio stations in Seattle for the program directors.
Right.
And where they were trying to promote her single.
Sure.
Basically. So we would do that, take them out to lunch, you know. We do a few radio stations and then I fly home. So then we go to like, you know, Southern California and right. do like the
so,
round
so,
there.
So were you like, all right, what qualifications do I need to be a chaperone? It's like, I can play guitar, but I don't know about the chaperone part, man.
Yeah. No, I mean, I didn't have to do anything. I just had to stay with her. You know,
right.
It wasn't a big deal.
Make sure she ate her vegetables and whatnot.
No, I mean, there were other people
sure.
there. It
I'm,
just,
I'm playing
you know,
with you.
Yeah, no, I know. I would have enjoyed that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so I did that for a little less than a year. And then I just continued to get called to do, to do gigs where, you know, like one set of music or for an artist. So I would be constantly learning their set lists. So I have like a, you know, a big folder bin of still now, like of with files for every artist that I played with and the charts, which is important because sometimes years later you get called for a gig with somebody. And I'm like, I'm glad I don't have to re-chart out all the music for this artist.
So was it always live performances? Did you ever get called in to do recording session type stuff? You did.
Yep. Both. And you know, most of the work comes from referrals. So when you do one gig with somebody, they might recommend you if you did a good job to their friends.
Right.
So after a while, you kind of just get to know more and more people on the scene and get called for different things. And
that's pretty that's the whole business.
Yeah.
My business, your business, it's all just referral. Who knows who can fill in, who can do this. Yeah. That's great. Yeah. So when did the, let's get you to, the Cyndi Lauper time period. That's fairly recent, right?
2016. So in 2014, I got called to play on the Meredith Vieira Show.
That was first. Okay, let's do that one first. Yeah. So what was that about? Yep. That's a whole different kind of gig—a TV accompanist, you know, band.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a lot of fun. I got called through Everett Bradley, who is the percussionist and singer for. Right now, he's playing with Bon Jovi. The last few years. But he, at the time, he was playing with Bruce Springsteen.
Wow.
So, yeah, no big deal. Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah, a couple of New Jersey kids, who cares?
Exactly, right. So Everett called me, also referral-based. I didn't know Everett at all. And they he left a voicemail that I've actually saved all this time because, like, changed my life. But he left me this voicemail saying, "Hey, like, just want to know what you're doing today, and I just want to talk to you about like a possible TV show that I'm working on. Give me a call." So I called him, and he was like, "How soon can you be at NBC?"
Wow.
I was like, "Well, I'm at a rehearsal now. Like, I have a gig tomorrow night. I don't know." No, and he was like, "Well, if you can just sub it out somehow." You know, and just get over here. We're about to start a TV show, and the person that we had playing guitar isn't working, so we need to like make an immediate change. So that's what happened. So I left my rehearsal. I went into 30 Rock, and didn't know anything about what was happening. So anyway, so Meredith Vieira was they were starting her daytime talk show, and she wanted to have a band, a house band, which is not commonly done. I guess Kelly Clarkson's doing it now.
Like, oh, is that right?
On her show, they have a house band.
Usually the daytime shows didn't have that kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, I think they don't want to pay for it because it's not necessary.
Right.
It's not, you know. Yeah. But Meredith's super cool, and she wanted the set to look like her house, and she wanted music in it, you know. So they got Everett Bradley to be the band leader, and then they wanted all females in the band.
Okay.
Them. So I went there. He had me play some of the charts, see if I could like read the music, and just, you know, he threw things at me, and he wanted to see how I could handle them quickly. "Can you play me like a Jimi Hendrix vibe on this song?" Like, sure. So I was also changing sounds.
Right.
Wanted to see how I could do that. And it worked out.
That's so cool. How long did that gig go for? How long was her show?
They did two seasons.
Two seasons.
So
now we're talking television, which is a whole other animal. Everything moves very quickly, as you saw right off the bat from your hiring. you know, you have to be ready to drop everything in 30 seconds when you're doing television. So what was that schedule like for you as a musician? Was it one of these, I got to get up at 4 a.m. to get...
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus. So
pretty much. I mean, not quite that, but our call time was 7, which is not bad, actually. But we were in hair and makeup right at 7. Jeez. And then we would film two shows. We would do one at 10 o'clock and one at 2 o'clock. And the one at 10 was, at some times that show was live, too.
Mm. Okay.
So.
And she had a live, she had a studio audience?
Yes, okay. Studio audience. Cool. Yeah, we were in Studio 6A, which is, for those of you who have done a tour of NBC or have worked in NBC, it's actually across the hallway from Jimmy Fallon's show, from The Tonight Show, with The Roots, and they're in 6B.
Right.
Yeah.
So what, I mean, you're basically playing in and out of breaks, I would guess, right? And doing some stuff for the studio audit, but did you ever have guests come in and sit in and do stuff with you?
We did have musical guests. We had like Tommy Two Tone randomly, and we played 8675309 Jenny with him. So that was cool for me, because as a guitar player, because I got to play all those riffs.
I know. Yeah. Fun. I mean, what's fun about you is the stuff you're doing for me anyway, this is the, you know, where I get a kick out of it is your Jagged Little Pill, you know, that's my, you know, youth, my mid 20s. Cyndi Lauper is my, you know, when I'm in high school or junior high school, you know, like you're playing all the people that, that I listen to, and it's pretty wild. And you did too, as well, because of your sister, right? I mean,
exactly.
This is the kind of stuff that you were infused with as a kid, and now you're playing with them and playing those tunes. It's gotta be wild for you.
It is sometimes. Yeah. When I step back from it, I'm like, wow, that's crazy. Yeah.
Wow. So out of the Meredith Vieira show.
Yes.
Is that where we get now? What's you're looking for your next gig, or you still go back to the sideman kind of lifestyle?
I wasn't looking at that point. I was still getting called for other things outside of the show. And actually throughout that time, our schedule was early in the day. You know, like I said, my call time was 7. We would be done by 3:30 or 4. Mm. So I was still playing gigs at night sometimes, you know. I was now in a position where I didn't have to say yes, nice. You know, to things I didn't want to do, which was really nice. But anyway, so yeah, so when that show ended, I was still doing all the things I had been doing, and teaching on the side too, recording.
Privately, or were you part of the,
teaching privately, yep. Which is what I did, you know, primarily leading up to all of this, to make money.
Right.
You know, teaching is always a great way to do that for musicians.
And aside from supplementing the income, do you like it? Do you like instructing?
I do. I mean, of course, I enjoy teaching students that care and are, you know, in practice and are, you know, just interested in it more than the opposite of that.
Right.
But yeah, I do. It's rewarding.
I taught acting very briefly for a while. I had a little studio for a while where I could only do adults because I just can't teach children. It's a whole other thing with acting. It becomes more improvisational games and things with kids, and I don't deal with children. So I was never good with them. So I taught adults, but I loved it because, like you said, when there's a passion, when they really want to explore something, there's something great about seeing where the light is off, where they don't get it, and then the light comes on, and they do get it. I would imagine you get the same thing.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's exciting. Yes. Yep.
So for you, what does that materialize? What does that look like? Is it, you know, some chord progression or some, they go home and learn a song and come back and play it for, like, what does that look like when, for you?
It can be. I feel like seeing the light bulb go off happens a lot in just understanding concepts. You know, sometimes it's like little theory, music theory stuff, like building a major scale or like just little fundamentals. But a lot of guitar players don't connect that with physically playing. Mm. So I think when you see people start to understand what they're playing, that's a cool moment.
So the connection of the theory to the practice.
Yeah.
Is...
yeah, and it can be light theory, but again, like just the understanding, you know.
Right. right? Why this sounds like this, why this works like that.
Exactly.
That's neat. All right, so let's get Cyndi in here, because I don't want to keep
you
too long.
Yeah. Yes. Sorry, I know.
So how did that come into your life?
Right, so the show ends, and same, actually kind of the same way I got called for the Meredith show, I got called for Cyndi. So I get an email one day from Cyndi's manager saying, hey, what are your plans in the next few months? You know, I managed some different acts. She was very vague about what it was. So I just wrote back and said, yeah, sure, I'd love to hear about your project, you know, whatever. So she calls me and she's the same question. How soon can you be at SIR? And I was like, half an hour. She's like, all right, well, let's say in 3 hours, just, you know, I manage Cyndi Lauper. She has a tour coming up that starts in 10 days and, we need to make an immediate replacement.
Wow.
And, you come highly recommended. And so can you learn time, money, and girls? And I'm like, as in like time after time.
Right.
You know, sure. Yeah. Anyway, so I got my shit together, got ready, played through the songs,
Time out. So what is going through your head when, first of all, you're like, all right, for the next 10 months, I'm going to be doing this. If I get this, and it's Cyndi Lauper. This is part of your youth, part of the musical. That's got to be a lot of stuff going through your head there.
Totally. Part of that, when that stuff happens, is that, like, in theory, you want to do it, right? Like, but it's also a huge decision that you're supposed to make immediately, like, right in this moment.
Right.
So, and in the meantime, get ready and be good and, you know, like, not think about that because you have to perform. I was kind of like, you know, my girlfriend was there, like we lived together. And when I was having this conversation, I'm like, Cyndi Lauper, I mean, I have to do it. Right. Not that I didn't want to, like, please, like, don't think that.
Absolutely.
But it, again, it's just like, okay, do I want to go on tour with Cyndi Lauper for the rest of the year?
Right.
Do I want to leave? Like, it's always like,
yeah, right from school, it was the same with you. It was like, all
right,
so for the next, can you come down to Nashville and suddenly change your entire life?
Okay. Exactly.
Can you come to 30 Rock and suddenly change your entire life? Can you come down here and come on tour and do that? So that's pretty
exactly.
And you have to make those decisions and not be afraid of where life is going to take you. You just got to.
Yeah.
Is that the kind of person, do you think, because now we're seeing a theme that this is the way your life has gone in certain turns. Did you see yourself that way? Do you think of yourself that way, where it's like you're quick to kind of jump off that branch?
No, I don't think I'm not. I like, you know, which is probably good, because if I had the opportunity to think about it more and just like, and really plan it, I'm like methodical and I like preparation and I don't like, you know, so maybe being forced to do it was the best thing, because maybe I wouldn't have done certain things, you know?
So when you go down there to audition, are you auditioning with her and her band, or how's that working?
Yep. Yeah. So they were actually in a rehearsal already. So, same thing, kind of like when I went to NBC, just like, okay, just put your stuff here and let's play.
Wow.
So I played through time after time, Girls Just Want to Have Fun and Money Changes Everything. With the band. She didn't sing. I met her and then she left the room.
Sure.
And I played for them. And then Bill Whitman, who is their bass player, musical director, and he's Cyndi's engineer. He recorded She's So Unusual. So he has worked with her for a very long time and been heavily involved in most things that she's done.
Wow.
So he was teaching me all the parts because he was there when they recorded them, you know. So, so those songs he was happy with those. And then he continued to teach me the rest of the set for their tour. So, and then they were like, do you have a passport? It was just like moving really quickly.
Wow.
So I was kind of in at that point, you know.
So once you get in and you're and now you're part of the band for this tour.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm curious. I mean, are you learning things about yourself, about music, about, you know, that level of artist? I mean, is it a new kind of experience for you?
That's a good question too. I mean, I would say it was a familiar feeling in that initially you have to focus so much just to learn the role, right? Like for like being an actor, like I'm sure. Where I was just kind of thrown into the situation and now I have to learn all of this music and like learn how to do it well. And just, you're so highly focused that you kind of can't think about anything else for a little bit.
Right.
Which is nice.
Yeah. Yeah. You got a job to do and you want to do it at a high level that is expected.
Yeah.
But as you're getting, as you go
then
on,
anyway.
Yeah, as you become friendly and you're working together and collaborating, it must be interesting to see that perspective.
Absolutely.
Like, did Cyndi's experience as an artist give you any stuff? Like, did you learn things about that whole scene, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, one thing that Cyndi does that's beautiful is that she wants things to be a little different. She, you know, we learn the songs and in general we do them in a certain way, but she always wants that element of surprise, like always that nervous energy. She likes moments of silence where you feel uncomfortable. She's a true artist.
That's great.
So it's still exciting and it can be frustrating as someone who, you know, likes to prepare and do all those things. So, but I've definitely learned a lot from her in that regard.
Curveballs of the moment, you know, see just whatever she can throw in there. And what if I always thought, you know, she's a huge pop star and everything, but what an amazing voice. Just pure, like a pure vocalist talent. Incredible.
She still like blows. I mean, she blows me away like every time. And she works her ass off. She still takes vocal lessons and does, you know, full warm-ups all the time, and she works her ass off. Yeah. That's what people don't see, you know?
Yeah, and I would imagine that you know a lot about that yourself, is there's, you know, the discipline to know all the things you know. You know, you're not just getting up there and strumming a couple of chords. It's, you know, there's such hard work that's gone into crafting what you know how to do.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And people don't see that. You know, and
they
should. Right. They don't realize how much work artists put into the actual craft to produce the art. So, are you still? Do you still play with Cyndi?
I do. Yeah. I didn't do. They went on a tour to Japan when Jagged Little Pill was starting, and so I wasn't able to do that. But I've done. You know, I think that was the last tour. That was the last tour she's done.
Okay.
2019. So I do, you know, one-offs, and we did a lot of recording this past year, even in the pandemic. We did a lot of like campaign videos for Joe Biden and Nancy Pelosi.
Now, when you're working in that kind of environment, obviously it's like you said, she likes surprises and things, and there's sort of a set way that she and the band have done their thing. But do you get to contribute things as you go along where they're like, well, you know, they're seeing what you can do and what you can bring, and you're like, hey, let me do this, let me try that. Are there things like that that happen?
Yeah, in a certain way. I think, you know, when you're working with an artist, you have to be careful about what you offer, you know, like to not come off like you're trying to I don't know.
Right.
You know, step on their toes.
Right. But artistically, you can offer things, you know, I would think at some point where you're like,
absolutely. Yeah. And she wants that for sure. And like, she usually has to make that clear, I think, for people because, you know, because we would lead with caution.
Right.
But then she'll try to pull it out of you and not always in the, you know, not always
right,
in the
good.
Most polite way.
Good. I
but
like
that's,
this.
That's okay. That's
so
what it is.
So what, know? If you can think of an example of, is it within a song, within a riff, or do this here or that, like what are some of the things where you felt you contributed something really cool or interesting to the something that was already set, you know, that kind of a.
Yeah. When we play Time After Time, she likes me to stand next to her when we start it. And she usually plays the intro on a dulcimer. So like she, that sits
oh, the thing
in front
on the flat.
Of her. And, yeah. Right. Yeah.
It's like a steel guitar kind of thing, right? Isn't it? Or something? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a three string horizontal, mm-hmm. you could say, guitar.
Kind of. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So she likes to play Time After Time and True Colors on that. And she likes me to stand next to her and she starts the intro. And then she wants me to kind of like play along with her. And we've gone through different variations of that. And so I feel like that can become a little bit collaborative. But most of all, she wants it to be like a special moment.
That's awesome. That must feel great to contribute that way as an artist where you're...
Totally, yeah.
All right, so before we get to... you mentioned Jagged Little Pill. Before we get to the Broadway experience, your partner, again, I'm not good with names. What's your partner's name?
Mishti.
Now, you guys play, right?
You guys are a
duo, or do you have a little band? And when did she come into your life, and what is the kind of stuff that you guys are doing?
So we started dating. We were acquaintances as guitarists for a while, and then we started dating in 2013. So almost 8 years.
There you go.
Yeah. And she has her own project. So I work with her on it. I wouldn't say it's a duo.
Okay.
It's her music. And she's really badass. She plays guitar. Not like we're very, very different. She plays with this like amazing, reckless, abandon energy, which I could never do. Like it's just like the opposite of what I would ever do. That's really cool. And I've been, when we record her music, I've been producing it and, you know, helping arrange the songs.
Okay.
And
so,
yes.
so is she writing music and lyrics, or are you writing with her? I mean, how does it work when a producer musician works with a singer songwriter like that? How do you guys do it?
In our case, a lot of these songs she had written before. And some of the newer ones, she has like ideas for like a verse and a chorus, and I would say I help her arrange it. So I would call myself more of an editor than a co-writer.
Right.
Yeah. Sometimes I'll take like, this is a great idea, but let's make the chords a little bit different here. You know, things like that. It's still like her writing.
Right. Do you ever, as a musician writer yourself, do you ever get a melody in your head or something where you're like, we got to try this. Can we try this? Let's do this.
I would say I'm not. I mean, that doesn't come as naturally to me. I feel, I would say I feel more, it's clearer. Is that a word? Is it more clear?
You could use either one with me.
Yeah.
Like I said, I'm a total moron, so it works. Either one will play fine on my show.
It's a lot more clear to me to revise that creativity, then pull it out of thin air.
Got it.
That's, you know, got which it. I think is a lot of why I feel more called to work as a side musician and help do that, like create that vision, then come up with it. You know? Right.
Yeah, I fall somewhere in between because I do write, and I've written screenplays, and I've written things, and I write poetry and things like that.
Wow.
But the gig is the acting. That's the fun one. The hard work is the writing and the creating and the filmmaking stuff. But if you give me the script and I just have to bring life to it, that's a lot more fun because it's, you know, I just have to find the truth in that. I don't have to pull it out of nowhere, you know.
Yeah, I'm with you. Right. I know for some people it's not the case.
Well, for some people, I envy the ones where it just spills it, where they can't not do it.
I had
John Hampson on here. Is the guy from 9 Days, the singer songwriter from 9 Days, who had that one hit
story of a girl,
and he's like that, where he talked about how that song came and how the music comes to him, like it's words and melodies all at the same time. Like, how does that even so I'm always fascinated with where the stuff comes from for you guys, because it's very different than like what we do. So, all right. So, Jagged Little Pill. Let's get here. Alanis Morissette and a Broadway version of her music, which they do a lot now. A lot of these Broadway shows are these sort of musical anthologies that they string a story through.
Exactly. Yeah.
And how did that find you? How did you find that?
So I had been the way Broadway works with musicians is the shows are contracted by a few different people, like a few main contractors. I'm not sure if that, I guess that's probably like casting people. Right.
Yeah. I don't know how it relates, but yeah, I don't know anything about the music part of Broadway. I don't know. So.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. So basically they know when they're going to do a show, they know that they're the instrumentation. And then a contractor, like, is a person that handles the hiring of the musicians. So those people know a pool of musicians, and they draw from that. So I had been contacted maybe 2 or 3 times about other shows and potentially doing those, and they didn't work out. Yeah.
Okay.
One of them was Waitress, and another was Head Over Heels, the Go-Go's show. And for different reasons, they didn't work out.
Right.
But when I was contacted about Jagged Little Pill, and, you know, I'm a huge Alanis fan. And, you know, I got Jagged Little Pill for Christmas in 95.
and Santa was good. He got you the guitar and Jagged Little Pill. That's pretty awesome.
God, totally. Yep. Yeah, so I, you know, any hesitation that I may have had about doing Broadway, which is, you know, doing 8 shows a week and playing the same show every time, which is not like what Cyndi Lauper is, you know. So any hesitation I may have had was kind of like set aside for the fact that it was Jagged Little Pill and like I would be able to play that music.
Yeah.
So I said yes to that, and that started in 2019.
And
the end of 2019.
You guys are, I think you're on stage, right? Like you're like it's you're in the show. You are the show.
Yes.
You're on it. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, you know, not through the whole show, but we're on 2 moving platforms that are on the side of the stage. Half of the band is on one platform and the other half, and then sometimes we come together and sometimes, so we're also like moving, which is a little disorienting.
It's like being in it, trying to do a dinner theater in a restaurant that turns around and around.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, does that sound fun?
Yeah. Oh yeah, it sounds like a blast. It sounds like a trip to the side of the ship to puke over the side.
Exactly.
So when you get in, first of all, this is an interesting experience. Is it what is the first days of rehearsal like for a Broadway gig like that? Like, is it, you know, there are the actors and here are the, like, is it 2 different worlds, or how are you working together? How does that work?
Yeah. For this particular show, for me, it was a different world. And it still is, actually, because I think it comes down to budget reasons, but they can't have the whole band rehearse with the show most of the time. Mm-hmm. So my first rehearsal was like, I don't know, a week before the first preview. Like, I hadn't even like,
wow,
I didn't know what the show was about. I didn't know anything. So they only have like a few people rehearse with the cast outside of, you know,
right.
Yeah. Normally. So that's common.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, so I started rehearsing with them and then started to see some of the scenes and I was like, oh wow, this is heavy. This is a heavy show.
Right.
Yeah.
So what's interesting is, because you're a fan, right?
Yeah.
And you started what do you say? Like, how many days before previews were you got into rehearsal?
I mean, I feel like it was a week. Maybe it was 10 days
All right,
before
so,
previews.
So 10 days and you're a fan of the album to begin with.
Yeah.
What the arrangements have to be different, right? It's got to be.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
It's mm-hmm. like this isn't yep. really Jagged Little Pill. It's these right. are the songs. But what was that like for you to see that and adapt to the different kind of arrangement of these tunes?
Yeah, I mean, some things are a lot much like the original recording. For instance, if you're very familiar with the album, then the whole album.
Not the whole album. I mean, I like Alanis, but I don't remember all the songs yeah. on that album.
So, like, there's a song called Forgiven on that, where the guitar intro is this kind of gnarly chorus, like modulated sound.
Right.
And I get to play that in the show, and it's supposed to be like the album.
Right.
So a lot of that song, particular song sounds like the album.
Right.
Other songs, sometimes like we do a little part of it. Yeah. I'm trying to think if anything's like extremely different
yeah, is it
guitar-wise.
Is it Broadway-ified? Like, is it, because I haven't seen the show, is it, because Broadway singers are mm-hmm. different than rock singers.
Yes, yes. I mean, it is. Like, but in a good way, yeah. and it makes sense. The end of the show, we play, You Learn is the last song, spoiler, sorry, You Learn is the last song in the show, and it does the, whole step modulation at the end, you know, takes it up, and then they right. bring in another song, part of a song, and overlap them. You know.
Yeah, she brings in, I think I saw a video, guys, you guys did a YouTube thing where she brings in Thank You, right?
Exactly, yes, exactly, yeah, in the new key. I know, and I think it's great.
It is.
That would be like a very Broadway way of doing that, yeah. I would say. But it makes sense.
While you got involved with the piece, what was Alanis' involvement? Did she, I guess, was she a producer on it? Did she come in and watch and think about and talk about things? Did you get involved with her at all?
I think she did when they were working on the show. I've never met Alanis Morissette.
Really?
Okay. Nope. So I would love to.
Yeah. I'm sure she'll want to meet you. You know, just as, you know.
I don't know.
You never know.
I don't know.
These are the circles you're in now, you know. That's yeah. You're just not going to. That's so cool.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think she was part of the development of the show. And they did a whole run in Boston before they opened on Broadway. And I know she was involved in those right. rehearsals.
So you yeah. said to me to get us, and this brings us right back to the beginning. We'll wrap up in a couple of minutes. Mm-hmm. But the.
Sure.
You're thinking maybe the fall you'll get back to doing that again.
I think so.
Or earlier, but the actual who knows? We just don't know right now with the pandemic.
Yeah. I mean, maybe the fall, right? Yeah. I think, you know, everyone has to get vaccinated, and I'm not sure how they're going to restrict audiences. And
how does that...
It's hard to say.
How does that affect other things you do? Because it is a gig. It's like a job, you know, 8 days, 7 days a week. You know, how does that affect other things you're working on?
Right. Well, one nice incentive, you know, for musicians to work on Broadway is that after there's an initial lock-in period, which means that when you start a show, I think it's you have to do 6 weeks of all of the shows. So meaning that you can't be absent. You can't have like sub out, as we call it, okay. Have another musician play the show. After that time, you can sub out 50% of the time.
Sweet.
And keep your chair. So that's why a lot of musicians like having that Broadway gig, because it's there. You know, it's like something that you can always do.
That's a great gig.
Yeah.
That is a great gig. I didn't realize that. That's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So then you get, you can, if something comes up, you can kind of go do, you can record here, or you can play a gig
exactly.
there. That's very cool.
Yep.
So anything, just last couple of things. Anything out once we clear out of the... First of all, the pandemic has probably been... I mean, it's been difficult for all of us in so many ways. I had this COVID thing a year ago, so that was a disaster. So it was just awful. But at the same time, we also... I assume you're like me, where we've gotten to kind of be at home and adjust and work on things and work on stuff that we... didn't get to. Has that been your experience as well, where you can work on?
Totally. Yeah, I've loved doing recordings for people at home, actually, right. Which I would do some of anyway, but now it's been a lot more. I don't know. I think that's a good way of putting it. Like, we've definitely gotten used to this rhythm.
Right.
And hopefully we can, you know, find a way to combine both. Maybe,
yeah.
Right? And
yeah.
not be so like overextend ourselves when we go back.
True. And there is something that about the human to human experience that we can't lose, that I don't want.
Sure.
I hope that this doesn't become such a convenience that we forget that there is that synergy when you play with people there, or you act with people there, or whatever it is. There is something that we don't want to lose with that. So when we get out of this, is there anything you got going on? Anything besides Jagged Little Pill that maybe is looking lined up?
Well, I'm actually working on the new Michael Jackson musical, which was supposed to be open. It was supposed to open a year ago, actually. Almost. No, well, in the last summer. So I was going to move to that show, and I'm still planning to do that. So that is now supposed to open in February.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
So there, well, you get to do a little Eddie Van Halen in there, right?
Exactly.
That's, what was it? Billie Jean or Beat It or one of those that
he'd sell. Yeah, Beat It. Yep. Right?
All right. So last little thing before I let you go, let's just talk about, because you are a teacher and you do get to help inspire and impart knowledge, musical craft. Mm-hmm. What do you tell the young artist who has that passion you had, where they're carrying their guitar around even they don't know how to play it, and they're walking around their house with it, and like what is the advice you'd give to them about art, about craft?
About art and craft. I would say to really follow the music that speaks to you. But also not be afraid to put yourself out of your comfort zone. There's a lot to be learned from jazz, like for me, going to school for jazz, and there's a lot to learn from things outside of what you love. However, so I guess I'm saying like the marriage of those two things is beautiful, to be able to study other arts within your craft, but stay true and don't be afraid to follow the genre, let's say, or path that you knew in the first place, you know, that you love.
And at this point in your life, what are the things that are inspiring you, or that you're listening to? Has that changed? Do you still listen to new music? You still listen to old music? I mean, what are the things that are in your orbit that turn you on and get you to pick that instrument up and want to dive in again?
I mean, I would say that I don't search for music anymore. I would say that, like, having done this professionally over the years, I'm not necessarily the music lover that some of my friends are that aren't professional musicians, you know. I would say I'm that way with food, with cooking, and that is like something that inspires me and interests me constantly. The music, I still just enjoy being having the homework, let's say, like having a task to do. So like when an artist calls me to record something for them and it's a song that I haven't learned, but I enjoy the task.
That's
and like what, you know what I mean? Like what I,
you're a true working artist. You'd like to, like,
I guess. Pick up that's not like,
no, it's cool. It's the,
pretty answer, but
I totally get that. You want to open the hood and be like, all right, well, I love that performance, but how did he do that?
That's what I really enjoy about music. Not to say that like we don't sit around and listen to music sometimes. We do. We certainly do. But yeah, I get a lot of joy out of having something to accomplish.
Well, I'll tell you what, Alex, I have gotten a lot of joy out of this conversation.
Oh, thank you so much.
This is really enlightening and incredibly accomplished career, and it's still going on and with lots of fun stuff looks like ahead of you. You just keep rocking out, man. That's the coolest thing ever. And the discipline and the preparation that you love, but at the same time the freedom of spirit to go with the moment.
Yeah, absolutely.
And follow the rhythm of where it's taking you is how you got to be the artist you are. And I certainly appreciate all the time you gave me.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Awesome.